things going on in our lives, and He has afforded us another opportunity to be here to worship Him and to commune with Him. So I would like to invite anyone who has anything on their hearts, anything they want to present to God, whatever it is, this is the time where we come to God in prayer. And so we want to invite anyone who would like to come to the front to pour their heart before God to do so now as we pray.
Why we believe what we believe, and we have to be ready to teach them, right? We talk about if your friend tells you, why do you believe the Bible? Maybe someone wrote it, you know, it's not true. You tell them, no, the Bible is true. God is the one who wrote the Bible through His servants, and things that have been written in the Bible, prophecies are happening. Some already happened, and some will happen, all right? Someone else? How to prepare for the second coming? Yes. Oh, of course, we should be reading the Bible more often. How, as in how often? How often do you think we should be reading the Bible? Yeah, every day, but how many times in the day? Like? All right, she says two. We say that it's very important for us to schedule time. Right? When, as soon as you wake up in the morning, you make sure that you read your Bible and you pray. Then you can set up your time and say,
And now your burden's lifted and carried far away. His precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember when you walk, sometimes you will fall. Fall on Jesus. Fall on Jesus. Fall on Jesus. And live. Sometimes the way gets lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, and live. And when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain the joy inside, dance for Jesus, dance. can live.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
In my haste today, I left my Bible sitting on my desk. So I feel a little naked, so I need a bulletin or something to have in my hand, right? I have to ask you this to begin our session. We've been asking this on and off throughout these 2 weeks, and this is probably the second most important question that I ask you. Have you had your water today? Sounds a little weak. Did you get up and have your water that wakes you up and starts all of your processes to going? Water wakes up your brain. Did you know water increases your metabolism? Wow. It jumpstarts your digestion, helps your kidneys to begin to flow. Did you have your water today? Yes. And if not, what have you been doing? Because, you know, the reason I emphasize these things so often, it's not the difficult things that we do from day to day that makes our day. It's really the simple things that you do, that you remember to do, that you make a habit that form the habits that create the fabric of your life. So if you're having a difficulty changing something in your experience, you want to improve your life, you want to be better, you want to make changes, most of the time it doesn't happen because we take a piece of our lives this big and we try to carry it around on our shoulders. And what happens after a while is you get tired of carrying that because it's too big. So you say, oh Lord, help me with my burden. And no help comes. You're carrying this thing. I've got to remember to pray a certain way and live a certain way and do certain things. And I'm carrying this burden. And then finally you hear Jesus say, put it down. He said, come unto me. Those of you who are burdened and are carrying that big thing around, he said, come unto me. He said, set that down. He said, because what I would have you do with your life is easy. Wait a minute, Jesus. You have told me I have to be like you. I have to do this good thing. Stop doing that. How in the world could Jesus say this is easy? How many think it's easy? How many has it been easy to make the changes that you feel God wants you to make? It's easy. Piece of cake, no problem. What is Jesus talking about that's easy? The one thing that he's telling you to do is come and commune with him. Sit. And get your glass of water by all means. just sit and share with him the things you find difficult. He has not asked you to do heart surgery on yourself. That is difficult. Heart surgery on, could you take the first cut? The doctor puts the scalpel in your hand and says, go to it. Can you make the first cut? We wind up cutting our head because we're too nervous to make the first cut. what you do is begin to transfer. You guys, some of you missed last night, we were talking about some physics. How many enjoyed physics in school? I caught you. Last night we went over the physics of love, the transduction of heat. And really, the laws of thermodynamics, part of it says, thank you, sir. Part of it says that energy, the first law says energy is neither created nor destroyed, but it is transferred. It is transferred, and that transference of energy makes a change in the thing that transfers it and in the thing that receives it. That is the first law of thermodynamics. So, in the burden that I have, I cannot destroy my burden. We can't pretend that it doesn't exist, but neither can I. I'm strong enough to carry it around. So what should I do? Transfer the burden. That's why Jesus said it is easy, because I simply transfer the burden. I don't try to change the burden. I don't try to get rid of the burden. I don't try to pretend that it doesn't exist. I transfer the weight to God. And that's why he said it's easy. It's easy. He has all power. Give it to him. When we use that word or that phrase, give all your burdens to Jesus, how do you do that? How do you do that?
Surrender.
How do you surrender? Give up. How do you give up? You lie on the floor and give up. Now what? You know what gets in the way of giving up? You've got to go to work. You got things to cook. You got clothes to wash. You got rooms to, you got children, you got grandchildren. That gets in the way of laying on the floor and doing nothing, doesn't it? What does it mean to surrender then? What does it mean to give up? That's why it's difficult for us to change, is because we've left these things to be religious instead of understanding what God is asking us. If I said to you, now listen closely, I don't want you to miss this. Galea in tres partes tabisa est. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah. We heard. It's the same thing when you say surrender and you don't know what it means. You do nothing, you glare at me and say, what? What does it mean to surrender? It means simply that I agree with God that the priorities that he has for me are the ones I am willing to accept. It means that if God wants me to live a certain way, his priorities will replace my priorities. His methodologies will replace my methodologies. His system I am willing to commit to. That is surrender. Now that's in English. Are you willing to live the way I want you to live? That's what God is asking when surrender. Not some religious thing. I surrender all. That sounds good, doesn't it? But it doesn't change your life. It doesn't change your life. Satan loves that. Satan loves when we speak in religious terms that we don't understand or neither would transform us. He loves it because nothing happens. nothing happens. Love will transform your life, either for the good or for the bad. Whatever you love, if you love ice cream, give it a moment. It will change your life. It will change your shape. It will change your health. It will change your everything. You see? Even misplaced love will transform you. That's why you have to be careful what you love. Okay? So, the title of the message, or the subject, I'm going to try to teach more than I preach today, hopefully, is the return of love. And before, you know, you've heard about the prodigal son, don't try to get ahead of me, because you don't know what's return and you don't know what that is. So wait and listen, okay? The return of love is what we're talking about. And today's final message, we call this week a week of commitment, and this is going to be what I would consider the crowning message of that commitment. So I want to tell this story of the prodigal son, and we know this, so I don't even have to have my Bible, but you should look in Luke chapter 15. It's very interesting, because this young man, father had two sons, doing well, successful, and the father has obviously servants and lands and money, and the sons, as they will, they kind of look at this and say, I like this. I like living like this. This is good. I just wish my dad knew what to do with this. If he was smarter, he would make different investments, and he would... Fathers, have you heard that? You, in all these years, you've been taking care of your children, but all of a sudden, now they know better how to negotiate life than you. So his younger son came up and eventually got the boldness and the nerve to say, you know what, Dad? I've been watching you, and your investments haven't done very well. I think you should give me the portion that you would give me if you were going to die. I mean, you realize that's the only time he would normally get that, is if his dad died. So basically, he's saying, Dad, can we pretend that you're already dead? What a bold move, Dad. Do I have to wait till you actually die? Can you go ahead and give me what you would give me if you were already dead? Boy, the father was more gracious than me. I would have had a few more words to say. I would have had a different speech, right? So you want me to die? I would have kind of delved into that a little bit. But the father was wiser than me. He said, you know, wow. You sure you know what to do with this? Are you sure you know you can handle this? And then amazingly enough, he gave it to him. All that he would have gotten at that point if the father was dead. He said, Dad, basically, from this point forward, you're dead to me. I no longer need you. I no longer need to live by your rules. I no longer need to live under your household. I no longer need your guidance or your authority hanging over me like a dark cloud. Today, I'm done. And he walks out. It says, matter of fact, he wanted to get as far away from his dad as he could get. He went into a far country. You know how we are, young people, if we're close to our parents, they can hear our music, you know? When we're getting into that rhythm. You know, dad wouldn't, mom wouldn't, they don't like that, so that if I go the next town over, if I go the next, well, let's leave Ontario altogether. Let's get too far away. Let's go to the U.S. That's pretty good, right? So I can do what I need to do. He started partying with his friends, or his friends started partying with him, because it was his money that was being spent. And sooner or later, he said, you know what? Funds are running low. Why don't we spend you guys' money for a while? You know what? And I think the party's over. And then he went down and down and down till he found himself in a place. It was hard to get that next meal. He was used to eating organic. And now he was eating truly organic. he had sunk it to a point where he was jealous of what the beings ate. He said, boy, that looks good today. Can I get some? The pig looked at him with a look. He knew, no, this is not for you. How long did he stay there? In that place, we're not told. He was used to living off this money he had, and he had to actually, can you believe it, find a job. Can you believe it? He had to find a job where he had to work with his hands. I think in many ways, if our young people would learn to work with their hands while they're young, then working with their minds would be more appreciated when they got there. But we suffer, and then we make our parents suffer because we want to be professional. We don't want to ever have to soil and get our hands dirty. Mom, can you help us out? Can you support us? Can you pay our rent? Pay our food? But I don't want to do what you say, but can you do that for me? If you love me? Wow. This father didn't do that. He said, son, you've got it. Whatever you've got, you've got. You go, you do what you're going to do. He found himself with the pigs. He found himself in the mud. He found himself in a bad time. And then what happened is one day, love returned. When did love return? Huh? Okay, see, I gave you a clue and you caught it, right? The love, most of the time we say the love was when he gets back to his father and he gets home and he's in the right. No, that's not when love returns. Love returns when you return to your senses. When you finally recognize that the road and the place and the position you're in is not the right place. So, I want to break this down a little bit. We know this story, because there's another part of it, and boy, this isn't working very well. I'm going to need some help. Social inheritance that we get that we have nothing to do with. We are born in a certain place. You didn't choose that. You're born at a certain time. There's a certain amount of wealth or whatever that your parents have or don't have. That's your inheritance. You get it? And somehow or another, you take this and this is what you become. You can't see it, but this is this native guy kind of dancing with headdress and all. What is he doing? If you could see this picture well, these little things here are people in the shadows, you know, joining him in his ceremony. These are like the friends that were helping him or hurting him, whatever you call it, that he lived his life with. What he got from his father, this inheritance, is what he used to, let's see if this is going to work. Help me out here. Just push it. To shape his personal beliefs. What your father gave you, what your mom gave you, it forges our personal beliefs, and we find ourselves dead in sins and trespasses. This whole idea of being dead in sins and trespasses is not, please, this is not just a religious term. We kill ourselves by making all this stuff religious. What is really God is saying is, you inherit a certain way of thinking and being. Your parents were either physically strong or weak. You may have a leaning a little bit. You have a leaning a lot. You have no leaning based on what? What your parents did or didn't do. What your grandparents did or did not do. But then socially, we absorb ideas and thinking from everybody around us. Our culture tells us how to wear our hair. Our culture tells us how to wear our clothes. Our culture tells us what food we should eat, what looks good, what doesn't look good. That's our inheritance, and we go off, and sometimes we become savage natives, so to speak, right? So what happens is, yeah, just sit there, man. This goes to an unproductive life. This is what this young person did. So your unproductive life grows out of how you think, your mindset, the setting for the ideas and values you have. That is how we gain an unproductive life. It doesn't just happen, right? But because of our setting, we get there. Push the button for me, please. What God allows to happen is this hunger and thirst, what I call the empty life syndrome. Parents, grandparents, listen to me on this. Listen to me. You do your child the greatest harm by sheltering them from the hunger and thirst, sometimes literally, that they will go through. You understand what I'm saying? This father let his son go, and the very thing that saved him, that God used to save him, was what? Hunger and thirsting and hard times and hardship and pigs and husks and everything. But when you say, this is my baby, I'm going to help them, I'm going to pay out of my pocket, I'm going to support them, even if they are living a lifestyle that I don't agree with, you are killing them by protecting them from the hunger and thirst that God sent their way. Do not interfere. Love your child. Love your grandchild. But if they will not follow good things, then sometimes the best thing is a little hunger and a little thirst. Sometimes that's the best thing. I know that's a hard thing to swallow. But out of this young man's hunger and thirst, what came? The awakening. That is repentance. We think repentance is when I start doing things and I start cutting off things and I take off things and then I stop doing things. That's not repentance. Repentance is when I allow God's standards to once again make sense to me. When I begin to awaken in my mind and say, you know what? The way God said to eat is, maybe that's strange to me, but that's what I want to do. He began to recognize, he said, wow, my father has servants that eat better than me, live better than me, dress better than me. I will arise. That is repentance. When repentance happens, you, in your mind, arise. Where was he when he arose? In the pig pen. He had not moved. He had not changed his clothes. He had not cut his hair. He had not taken a bath, probably. But he had awakened. Love returned to him and his experience while he was in the pig pen. We must remember that about people we come in contact with, that the love comes back while they are still dirty, not when they're cleaned up. When they're in the pig pen and you don't want to be close to them and you don't want to get that smell on you, that's when love has returned to them. Oh. You want to try again? Okay. So then out of that pursuit, reform comes. Once you have repented, then what did he say he was going to do? I'm going to rise and do what? Pursue my father. Now I begin to change. How long did it take him to get home? He didn't say, did it? How long should it be when a person is starting on his way to God, all of a sudden do all the things you want them to do? Oh boy, we're getting in deep territory now. Oh boy. He had to walk home. He had to, maybe it take him days or weeks to walk home. He had to make a pursuit of God. That is what brings reform to my life, is pursuing God. Not trying to remake myself by heart surgery, but pursuit of God. So now new practice and habits, then you see how long it took that transformation to come down? Where did it come from? Up above, and it comes to me. It's not, it didn't come from me. We tell people, oh, I struggled before I made my commitment to God. Please, you were in the pig pen. What struggle did you do in the pig pen? You were already in the pig pen. You couldn't go any lower. That's why you, okay. Okay, so would you still eat it? Why not? It's protein, they tell me. You don't want that kind of protein? What's, okay, you guys, man. So here's the thing. If this landed next to your plate, even on the edge of your plate, when you were eating, would you still eat?
Yes.
You see what's happening? Oh. Transformation is not my work, but it needs my cooperation. It's the same animal. It's the same thing. One form. Okay. Let's ask the question. Okay, because it's out of the cocoon now. Do you have a caterpillar life? What's a caterpillar life? You know what that is? We just described it. You're slow. You never move fast enough. Your life is never moving fast enough, right? People don't like you, and they tend to want to consider you ugly. And then they try to say, you're down there, you're no good, you are. And then worse, they brush you away or stomp you. Do you ever feel like that's your life sometime? That you, no matter how you struggle, no matter how you do things, you can't just quite make it to the place you want to be. You are stuck. And your name isn't Chuck. You're stuck. But the thing you have to realize is that transformation often starts here. The same thing you said, oh no, this fella my food, I'm done with my food. This is the same creature that eventually becomes that creature. Do you have a butterfly life? You're quick. Things are happening for you. You're admired, right? What else? You're considered beautiful. I mean, if a caterpillar was on your leg, you would jump, wouldn't you? Oh, get it off me, get it off me, get it off me. But if a butterfly landed right in the same spot, you said, shh, don't scare me. Don't scare me. What's wrong? It's the same thing. And sometimes in our experience, we treat people as if they are caterpillars instead of on their way to being butterfly. We have to be all so careful. I know I do. Maybe you don't, but I have to, because butterflies fly high. It's nice to be up where you're flying high, where everything looks good, everything's in place. I got, you know, some people get so high, they're flying. They say, caterpillar, why don't you get yours? I got mine. You just need more education. You need a better job. You need to see. You're just flying high because you just escaped the cocoon. Let's look at this, because there's one other thing. This is desired and sought after, but look at this. Number one, they're one and the same. The same person that began a destitute life, a life that's spiraling downward, is the same one that God can transform. And that's why God loves us. He doesn't love us because we are caterpillars and wrapped up by our own cocoon. That's not why he loves us. God doesn't love us because we're ugly and we can be ugly and we can be ugly to other people and we can be stoppable, if you will. He loves us because he sees the potential of what we can be once we are freed. Once we are let go and transformed. So I want to hurry. Transformation happens as we learn to push against negative voices. Sometimes you have to do that. Push against negative voices, people telling you to stay where you are. Number two, break through the obstacles you meet. How can you break through the obstacles you meet? Oh, you haven't worked in 6 months. You haven't. Maybe God is saying, look somewhere else. Look somewhere differently. Look at different things. Do different things. Ask different people. Move. Pray. There's a saying, push. Pray until something happens. Trust what God has placed in you. If the caterpillar listened to us, he would kill himself. He would kill himself. He would say, you know what? I'm just a caterpillar. I'm ugly. And I should fall under this boulder and let it fall under me. And no. Don't trust what God. If the caterpillar somehow or another envisions that God has done something already great, it just has not been revealed yet, it will patiently wait for the transformation. And then follow nature's outlines. Somebody tells you, there was a story about a farmer who saw a cocoon, and he watched this cocoon hanging on a tree. And then one day, the cocoon fell off the tree, and he said, wait a minute. And the butterflies started coming out, but it was struggling to get out. It couldn't quite, it was just struggling to get out. And he said, oh, no. So he took out his knife, and he cut the cocoon open. The butterfly soon was free, and then it promptly died. What happened? So he took this to a scientist and he said, look, it died as soon and nothing, it was all right. He said, the butterfly was, it strengthens its wings by struggling to get out of the cocoon. Amen. If you, by helping it, you killed it. Had you let it struggle till it was out and free, then it would have had enough strength to go ahead and fly. But because you helped it, you killed it. You created weakness, and it could not survive. Follow what God has outlined as nature. Obey the laws of God. So I'm going to hurry on because I want to finish here. Just a few lessons about transformation. Change is random. Change is usually random. Change happens all the time. Change, we change clothes, we change shoes, we change cars, we change foods. Change happens all the time. That's the problem. Change is too changeable. Change is happens. But when there is no purpose to our change, it's called a what? An accident. When there is no purpose to the change that you're making, it's an accident, okay? So, metamorphosis describes the process of purposeful change. That is what God is looking for when he says the process of salvation is really a process that leads us to purposeful change. It's not something that is instantaneous. Justification, where God forgives our sins, is instantaneous. But the process of salvation is a process, and it culminates when Christ comes. See? I'm not literally saved till Jesus comes and gets me, but I have the hope of salvation the moment I accept his plan for my life. Right? So God does not simply want us to change. He desires to give us purposeful transformation. So transformation always have a purpose. I'm hurrying, but I should have let that happen. Okay. So transformation has a purpose. So we start out with change. We continue with metamorphosis. We go to transformation. The simple process. So the Bible, and this is just kind of a review from what we have done, because I don't want you to forget these things. Number one, the purpose of God's plan is to give me what? Purpose. It gives clear instructions about what I should do, clear instructions about what I should think or be. Then secondly, it gives me focus. It calls attention to what? My daily habits. That is critical to transformation. If you try to skip that, then it won't work. It won't work. Thirdly, he gives me confidence that I'm doing what is right. He gives me direction, because I am lost after all, right? He leads me in the correct path, and then he gives me success. That's what God's word should be doing. If this is not where your life is, you need to make some changes that will enable you to get on the right road. If you're finding you have no purpose, no focus, no confidence, no direction, and no success, then something is wrong. Right? Success doesn't mean you have all the money you need and all. That's not success, right? Because Joseph was actually successful when he was in Potiphar's prison. So what do we mean success then? Success means that after you've examined all the dynamics of your life, that you are where God intended you to be. Just like that caterpillar, it is successful as a cocoon, it is successful as a caterpillar, and if he waits, he can be successful as a butterfly. Success means I am where God wants me to be, when God wants me to be there, and doing what God intends for me to do. So, do you recognize this? Oh, come on, you don't have to be shy. Do you recognize this? Look, I didn't put a name up there. How do you know that? So you all drive Mercedes?
No.
So how do you know this? It's all over the place.
Because that sign is associated.
Huh? This sign is associated with that?
Yeah.
Okay, Mercedes-Benz.
Yeah.
Branding.
Yeah.
They marketed this.
Yeah.
Do you realize there is a mark being put on you right now? You're either being branded as belonging to him, or you're branded as not belonging to him, and you are refuse. The question is, what is making that mark? That's the question. What's making that mark? Huh? You're making the mark? We are? Who I love? Who I love is making this mark. You know, that's an interesting thing, that the fact that you can recognize this says that there's something going on that people recognize automatically. But in you, the Holy Spirit is marking you, but it's based on, correctly said, who you or what you love. So that's why I say, when you get up in the morning, who do you love? What's the first thing you do? Young people, could you survive if your phone didn't work in the morning and you couldn't get on Facebook? Could you survive? Could you survive if you could not get your email for a day? Could you survive? If you couldn't send a tweet, if you couldn't call your friends, could, you know what? It would be wonderful Just test this. Go for a month without being on Facebook. 1 month. One month. No Twitter, no faith. Could you do it? That's true, you could. Would you do it is the better question. You see, the things that we do tell us what we love, you see? And give that up. Oh, no problem, I can do that. That doesn't, Facebook doesn't mean that much to me. Then do it. Make a vow to God at some point that, you know what, God, I want to see what I love. I am not going to use Facebook for a month. Okay, 2 weeks. The way God tests what we love is by stressing that relationship. He will stress that relationship just so that you can examine what you believe. You don't believe me? What happened with Daniel and the three Hebrew young men? He had come to a new country. He had his training. But then what happened? You got to eat like this or you're going to be killed. Would you call that stress? I call that stress. Right? How old was Daniel, by the way? 17. Young people, most of the characters in the Bible are young people. Daniel was not an old man when he did that. Neither were those young men. They were 17. Jeremiah was about 17 when he started preaching. They're about 17 to 20. What? Joseph was how old? 17. Huh? What is that saying? It's saying that God has made a calling on your life now, not when you get too old to enjoy sin. Oh, I'm old now. I'm all for the Lord. Because you can't do anything else. Okay, I'll leave that alone. God is marking us by what we love. Okay, so here we go. We're going to wrap up. Okay. This is what God is trying to do. And we got, I think, two slides. He is trying to get us back. If there's a big puzzle with thousands of pieces, and you're one of those pieces, and you fit in this puzzle a certain way, God is trying to make, it says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called in the hope of your calling. In other words, God has a perfect place for you in his program. And there's a perfect place for you to fit. And there's a perfect work for you to do. Here's the description. One Lord. And we said that means what? What does it mean, one Lord, one faith, one baptism? What does that mean? I'll give you time. Don't give me a religious answer. What does that mean? One Lord, one faith, one baptism. Huh? Unity? Okay. Huh? Okay. So I'm not going to stress you too much here. I'm going to give you... Look, one Lord means, and this is what happens when you repent, and you yield your life to God. One Lord means I only pay attention to one authority. Only one authority in my life has the right to tell me anything. If God tells tells me to eat a certain way, what am I going to do? I'm going to eat that way. If God tells me to dress a certain way, I'm going to do what? If God tells me to rest a certain time, what am I going to do? If God tells me to work a certain way or have my relationships a certain way, what am I going to do? That means one Lord. That's all he's saying. You only have one authority. Nobody else can tell you what to do, and you listen to it. One authority. Number two, one faith. That means God only works one way, and I only do it one way. If God says, Uzzah, you see the ark falling, don't touch it. Only the priest can touch it. What do I do if I see it falling? Let it fall and live. Touch it and, okay. That's the same message God is sending to us. Do it my way and live. Do differently, and the wages of sin is, oh, there it is. He's simply telling you how to live. One baptism, this is the critical thing. What could that mean? What could that mean, one baptism? What does that mean, one baptism? It means I commit myself to those first two tenets. I make a commitment that God is the only authority I have. I will eat, drink, dress, work, rest, everything the way he said. When you get baptized, that's what it means. God and God alone has the right to tell me how to live, and I promise I will not listen to anything else. Did it mean that when you got baptized? Did it mean that when you made your commitment to God and you said, I'm going to only do what God says and only eat what God says eat and only dress and only have my relationship and my marriage will go as far as in my power the way God wants me to do it? Was that what you did when you committed yourself to God? Because that's what that means. So this baptism is not just about unity in the sense of uniformity, but oneness with God. And this is why I call this the perfect pattern of unity. Watch this. This is just a side note, but I had to put this in. Watch this. One. Look, seven times one is mentioned. That seven is the perfect. That's the perfect pattern of unity. So you can examine this one body. We're united. One spirit. That means the same thinking and the same attitude goes through there. One hope. I don't have a hope in my job for paying my bills. I don't have a hope in my doctor for making me well. I have the hope of Jesus Christ and him supplying my needs and him healing my body. That's the only hope I have. Then I have one faith and one baptism which signals the commitment that I have. I don't have any other. I don't have any hidden agenda. Then here's the last one. One God. One God. One God. That's perfect unity right there. That's what you're committed to as a Christian. So, and I just threw this in. I think this is so interesting. I know we don't have time. I'm out of time. But let me go ahead and put it all up there. But this is an interesting life map.